Agree with that. Reason being, I don't believe those things that go against his will just because we want. I don't believe God gives us those things that don't line up with his word. I don't believe God gives us those things that he knows will bring us harm. Let me give you an example. I'm not going to mention her name because I don't always like to mention people's names over the pulpit like that. But you may know who I'm talking about. Maybe I've talked about her before. I'm not sure. But there is a well-known gospel singer, and she has acknowledged that God told her not to marry her first husband.
Wow. Yes.
Even the day of her wedding, God said, don't you walk down that aisle. But God, everyone is here. We planned everything. We paid for everything.
Yes.
And God, I want to marry him. I love him.
Yes.
So she went ahead and married this particular man. And the man ended up abusing her. It got so bad, I read this in Gospel Today magazine a number of years ago. It got so bad that she left. She drove away in her car with only the clothes on her back. Because she believed he was going to kill her. Now, did God go ahead and give her her desire to marry this particular man because she just wanted it so badly? No. What I believe is that, see, God, he warns us, right?
Yes.
He speaks to us.
Yes.
But one thing God doesn't do, he doesn't treat us like robots.
Yes.
He'll tell us what to do. He'll tell us his expectations. And then in the end, at the end of the day, it is our choice to obey him or not.
That.
So she married this man because she chose to.
Yes.
It was her desire. It wasn't God's desire for her. I'm not saying it wasn't God's desire for her to be married. It wasn't God's desire for her to marry this particular man because he knew what would happen.
Yes.
He knew that God knew that this man wasn't good for her.
Yes.
Let me give you another example. When I was a little girl, even as a teenager, I desired to have this angelic voice to sing. I grew up in the church, Mount Olive Holy Temple. It was a little church, but that little church used to rock there in Lincoln Heights.
Oh, yeah.
And we had some awesome singers in that little church, including my mother.
Yeah.
She had this angelic soprano voice. She had these notes that could break glass. My godmother, she's not here today, but my godmother, Sister Joyce Bird, had such a beautiful voice. My cousin Judy, Pastor Tony's baby sister, had such a beautiful voice. And there were others who could sing, but I named those three because I just remember as a little girl when they would get up and sing, all the congregation would get excited.
Yes.
Woo! And after church, oh, you sang that song today.
Yeah.
My God. And so I wanted that.
Yes.
I wanted to be able to sing like that, to hit high notes, to do all kinds of runs like my cousin Melvin. I want to be able to do that too. And the reason why I want to be able to sing, for one, because I've always liked music,
yes,
especially gospel. That's my favorite genre of music.
Yes.
But I also wanted the recognition.
Yes.
See, because the good singers, they got applause.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Oh, they got patted on the back.
Oh, yes.
I wanted that too. I wanted people to be in awe of me whenever I sang. But I didn't have that kind of voice. I had a voice that I could sing in a choir. Yeah. I can carry a little tune. Yeah. But I wasn't meant to be a soloist. And as I grew older, as I matured, I came to accept that. Although singing was something I enjoyed, it wasn't God's desire for my life. Hear what I'm saying? I'm not saying I can't sing at all. But not on the level I wanted, so I could show off my beautiful voice. And as I came to accept that, I was able to recognize what God's true desires are for me. What his purpose for my life is. I also came to realize that I was trying to live someone else's dream instead of my own. Because it seemed glamorous and exciting. Instead of seeing God, what do you want me to do? What gifts have you given me? God, show me. Help me see it clearly.
Yes.
Now you may ask, how do I know what my purpose is? because you may not know or you may not be sure. Well, first and foremost, for you to really come to the realization of what your purpose in God is, you have to first develop a close relationship with God.
Amen. Right? Amen.
True.
True.
Because it's His purpose.
True.
And we develop a relationship with God first and foremost by accepting Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, repenting of our sins and turning to Him. And then we grow in our relationship with God through studying the Bible, through prayer, through worship, in church, at home when we're alone. And I say church because being in church, it is imperative. No, going to church doesn't make you saved. Going to church doesn't automatically mean you're holy, but it helps. To be around other believers, other saints, to have people encourage you, hug you when you need it, pray for you.
Yes.
Oh my God, teach you.
Yes.
Open up your understanding to God's word. And as we develop our relationship with God, He opens our eyes.
Yes.
We see ourselves through His eyes.
Right.
We come to realize what our gifts are, what our purpose is. Here are a few questions for you to consider. What are you passionate about?
Right. What's your passion?
Yes. Here's another thing to consider. What do you do as a hobby? Steve Harvey. If you know him, he's a comedian.
Yes, he is.
Actor.
Yes, he is.
Talk show host.
Yes.
Radio talk show host. Game show host. Author.
Sure.
I heard him say that an individual's purpose is usually whatever he or she would be willing to do for free.
That's true.
And when you think about it, it makes sense. See, you freely do what you enjoy, what makes you happy, what fulfills you, what comes natural for you. You have a knack for it. Now, I mentioned about singing. I want to sing because it seemed glamorous and exciting, but it didn't come natural for me. Have you ever seen people who sing and it seems to be so effortless?
Mm-hmm.
Like they seem like they even barely have their mouths open and the sound just comes out.
That's true.
God gave them that gift. But for me, sometimes my voice would crack. And a lot of times I would sing off key. You have to get me back on key. On the other hand, I have a knack for writing. Just telling you about myself, just giving an example. For speaking, talking, I like to talk. I like to hear myself talk. I'll strike up a conversation with a complete stranger. I'll say something witty, something that will make them laugh. Stage fright.
Amen.
I may be a little nervous. I was nervous before I got up here. But I can get up here with no problem.
Yeah.
And then you have others that are like, don't make me go up there. No. And that's okay because perhaps they're meant to be behind the scenes.
That's
right. See, we all have our individual gifts. We all have our individual purpose. And they all play an important role. My God. And because I like to teach and I have a knack for speaking, I teach the word, I preach as you can see, God gave me a gift for acting.
Amen.
And for those of you who are visiting, you are all invited to my One Woman stage play on Saturday, April 28th at 5 p.m. right here at Harvard State University. Doors open at 4:30. I have a gift for acting. And I use it for the glory of God. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Prayer. Praying.
Come on.
I'm an intercessor. I'm going to become an intercessor. I didn't get to the level I am overnight.
Come on, sir.
I remember as a little girl kneeling beside my bed at night. Mom didn't make me do it. I mean, yeah, she taught us to pray, but it wasn't a thing where every single night, say your prayers. So I would get by the bed, kneel by the bed at night, and pray to God. Because I wanted to know Him.
Yes.
And I wanted to grow closer to him. And even as I moved into my teenage years, I remember I would be in church, particularly during the altar call, and I would just weep. I would just cry. I was such a crybaby in church.
Yes.
And I remember I was in college by this point, and we were at a service, and I was crying as usual during the altar call. I usually cry when I saw people give their lives to the Lord, or when the man or woman of God was ministering to them, and they were being so touched, they were being healed. Oh, it just touched me, and I would just cry the whole time.
Yes.
And my mom whispered to me at this particular service and said, "When you cry, you're interceding."
Come on, sis. Yes.
Before that, I didn't realize that that's what was going on. God was using me then when I didn't even know he was using me to intercede for others, to intercede for those who were at the altar.
Yes.
Oh! God wants you to live your dreams. In other words, God wants you to walk out his purpose for your life.
Yes.
And God is emphasizing the word "your" because if we're not careful,
come on,
we will find ourselves trying to fulfill a role God did not intend for us to fulfill. Please turn to Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12. Oh my God. Verse 11 says, "And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers." Verse 12, let's see what the purpose is for these particular roles.
Come on.
"For the perfecting of the saints," in other words, for equipping God's people, getting them ready, teaching them.
Mm-hmm.
"For the work of the ministry," bringing more souls into the kingdom of God. "For the edifying," that is building up, "of the body of Christ."
Yeah.
Now, some people operate in these roles identified in Ephesians 4, verse 11 and 12, when God did not call them to do so.
Uh-oh.
And why? Why are they trying to do something God didn't call them to do? Maybe it's because someone, man, told them, "This is what you should be doing." Even though it doesn't feel right. It's such a struggle. So out of place. But if you say so. Or maybe it's for selfish reasons. Because they like the recognition of having a particular title brings. Because it brings them amongst elite, or who they consider elite people. Other apostles and prophets and pastors. I get to run in circles with people like that. Maybe they see it as a lucrative business. Oh, if I give them a word that gets them excited, they'll give me a word. If I have a conference, and I'm not, hear what I'm saying, I'm talking about people who are out of God's will. And they're trying to fill a role that God did not call them to for their own reasons. They're totally in their flesh. Now, they may be called, but they're out of God's will. They're out of order. Example, a teacher. Perhaps a person really is called to teach the Bible, but they only teach what they want to teach. They teach what will get the people excited. They don't mention, the sin. Oh, God loves everyone. Oh, he loves you no matter what. You're okay. God loves you. He loves us all. We're all going to heaven. However, to be an apostle, a prophet, an evangelist, a pastor, a teacher, for example, is not something to be taken light.
Because
I'm going to be honest with you, I don't want to do this.
Say that. Oh my, yes.
I don't want to preach. I would say, oh my, I'm called to preach. I speak sometimes. But no, I'm not. God was like, yes, you are. You already know you are. Stop it. Because I understand that this is serious. James 3:1, you don't have to turn there. I'm reading the New Living Translation. It says, dear brothers and sisters, not many of you should become teachers in the church, for we who teach will be judged more strictly. So are you sure you're called? Use myself as an example. Once again, 4 years ago, God told me to write a play. 4 years ago. Looking at Sylvia. 4 years ago, he told me to write a play. Asked me if I wrote a play, and he told me. Who asked? I came up with this piece as well. I want to write one. Well, I'll wait to be inspired. I'll wait until God speaks to me. And I just went on about my very own way, staying in my comfort zone. See, I was comfortable being in other people's plays. Yeah, you know, I hid behind other playwrights, other directors, other producers. Because I only had so much responsibility. All I had to do was get the script, memorize my lines, go to rehearsal, listen to the director, and show up on performance dates, and invite people. And that was it. That's all I had to do.
That's right.
And if they didn't like the play, I didn't write it.
That's right.
Now, God is like, come on. It's time. It's past time. So now I'm doing this one woman stage play. Again on Saturday, April 28th at 5 p.m. here at Crown Faith Ministries. And with doing my own, I had to write my own script. I had to listen to the voice of God as he gave me the character and showed me, walked me through her life. Oh my God, through her emotions. And I just wrote. And it was amazing because it was like once I actually decided to sit down and write, it just came to me. I don't have the only thing to write about. But I did. God said, just sit down and just start and it'll come. That's for someone.
Yes, it is.
Just sit down and start, and it will come. I had to get the script copyrighted so that I own the rights to it.
That's right.
So if someone tries to come along and claim it, this was copyrighted on this date. Now, let me have to take you to court.
Right. That's it.
This is written by Kimberly Joy.
Amen.
Don't be mistaken.
Amen.
And that's for anyone who's working on their own scripts. Book, music, get it copyrighted. Oh my God, I'm talking about more things I had to do by stepping out of my comfort zone.
Yes.
I had to find a venue. And I want to thank you, Apostle, for allowing me to have my very first play here at the church.
Amen.
I'm responsible for making sure it gets promoted. And for setting up the entire program. So yeah, there's more. But God says that the blessings, oh my God, the greater I have for you, yes, the promises I made to you, they're not in the comfort zone.
All right.
Now,
Now, before you step out on faith and take action towards your dreams, you must pray for God's guidance.
Yes.
Right? Proverbs 3 and 6 says, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path.
Amen.
Oh my God. Like, look at Noah. We know that Noah built the ark, right? Because God said that the rain was coming.
Mm-hmm,
yeah. And when Noah built the ark or the cruise ship, he didn't build it his way.
Right.
He didn't take any shortcuts.
That's right.
But he built it exactly. If you read in Genesis chapter 6, you see the specifics. He gave them specific measurements. I mean, is that good enough? If Noah had built it his way or listened to people around him instead of listening to the voice of God, his family, the animals, probably all would have been destroyed in the flood as well.
That's good.
We're talking about live your dreams. God says live your dreams. Now, even as you come to realize your purpose, as God opens your eyes, now you may already know. It doesn't mean that everything will fall into place.
That
everything will be smooth and easy.
Come on.
More than likely, there will be obstacles along the way. More than likely, you'll feel discouraged. More than likely, things and people will come along to distract you, to get you off course. More than likely, there will be people who will let you know that they don't support you, that they don't believe in you, that they think you're crazy, that they think you're wasting your time. You're too old.
Say that.
Ooh, Shabbat, okay. But if God is still speaking to you,
yeah.
But he says it's not too late.
Glory.
He says you're not too old. He says live your dreams. So you keep pressing. You keep pushing. You be persistent.
Come on.
you love more than anything. He asked me, like, you're all in the chorus.
My God.
And I said, I love that. He said, that one woman play that you were writing that you had put off to the side. It's time.
Come on,
son. Was it okay? Okay, how about you and God? No. Because then this was the fear.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I need enough time.
Oh, yeah.
Right. 6 months.
Right.
God said, no.
Right.
Okay, July. No. Soon. May. No.
Wow.
It's February. April? Yes.
Amen.
I'll even give you to the end of the month.
Amen.
But that's it.
That's it.
Schedule it right now. And that very day I asked the pastor, can I have a play? I contacted Sister Annie who takes care of the church calendar. I'm going to do a play. Okay, girl, I'm doing it. I wasn't even quite finished with the script. At least I thought I wasn't. And when I went back and looked, I said, oh my God, it's almost done. I had written this song. I said that. Oh my goodness. God says it's time to move. Live your dreams. Live the purpose for which you were born. And again, if you don't know what that is, seek his face. And you don't have to have everything all figured out. I don't have everything all figured out. Things become more and more clear to me as I just walk. As I just take it one step at a time. I start off with a blog. Then I went from the blog to the radio. Now I'm going from the radio to doing my own plays. And I'm just going to keep walking. One step at a time. And then I'll do something else. And then my eyes become more and more clear. Because we want God to get the glory out of our lives. We say that, don't we? We say that, pray that. God, you be glorified. Be glorified in my life, Lord. That's a song that says, in my life, Lord, be glorified. God says, well, do you mean it? Then do what I said to you. We don't operate out of fear. I'm just sitting down. We don't operate out of fear. He didn't give us the spirit of fear, but he gave us the spirit of power. Doing.
Yeah.
I pray that this message has